Hi, it's Catherine McQuaid. I wanted to share with you some experiences on business-to-business sales within large corporations, and also to share with you some of the recently published research on how companies buy. And happily, if you've been out there on the street yourself, you'll find that some of this research is now validating our personal experiences. It was recently published as the Challenger Customer Corporate Executive Board in 2008 did some research on the sales process. Those findings were published as as Challenger Sales, and it's not Challenger in the space program. It's how this customer buying behavior challenges some of our assumptions about what we do as salespersons. So the first of 3 points that is important in terms of how companies buy is understanding that there is apparently an average of 5.4 stakeholders in any decision inside of a company. The second is that these stakeholders will have different views of the business challenge, which we're raising in our service or our product, and their different views of of the business challenge will often be as a result of being located in different parts of the organization. And the third point that's relevant is understanding that the human nature aversion to change, that the real competition to us is that it's easier to do nothing for a company. And therefore, our role is facilitating that internal movement towards consensus and helping them overcome the obstacles to change. That's what the sales activity is about. So we'll look at three different business cases. The first we'll start with is Cisco, and the point that we made here is that if we're going to help companies, all the stakeholders inside of a company come to agreement, the first task is to find out where the overlap occurs of the shared insight and how various stakeholders might find areas that they can agree about in light of the business challenge that we're raising. Cisco is the first example we'll look at. It's their WebEx service offering. It's a conference platform that you can connect to, and it doesn't have to be hardwired, and it's mobile platform friendly. So the benefit that they went out stating initially was device connectivity. Well, the chief marketing officer's response to that was frequently, we're developing a lot of different products internally, and we've got our own way of running our conferences. We've got a lot of analytical competence as a result, and we, by the way, run an awful lot of data through our conference platforms. The chief information officer's view is, well, if we take you on, we're going to have to do systems upgrades. It's going to affect our network architecture. And by the way, we run a heck of a lot of data through our conference platforms. So where did Cisco, how are they ever going to find a shared view of the business challenge? In this, they came back with, you both agree about data volume. This is how we're going to address the large amount of data that you both collect, track, and analyze. And the note for us here is that these different views of the world are not expressed. We as salespeople have to bring them forward. We have to sort of find them and then raise those as objections and make other stakeholders aware of them so that we can find that area for internal discussions that can help mobilizers, and that's a term that the Challenger customer uses to describe internal advocates of the business solution that we're raising. So the sales task is really to help the internal mobilizers, our champions, people who are willing to take on this business challenge and convince the rest of their colleagues that the company really would benefit by getting it handled, by making those changes. We're helping them overcome those obstacles by providing both validation tools and ways to take to look at risk and to reassure them that the downstream risk by way of implementation working out the way we planned it to, metrics of success, how do we measure whether or not we deliver what we've promised, return on investment calculators. These are all tools that we help equip the conversation towards consensus, a general agreement, and reducing the risk among all the stakeholders so that they would be then ready to make a purchasing decision. That's the Cisco example around how to build consensus and find that shared value that they can all then move towards. The second is Marketo. It's now a well-known marketing automation platform. At the time when they first went out to market, it was generally a new discipline. So initially, the responses that they received or the objections they received must have sounded like nobody understood what they were doing, and that they were generally, the responses must have sounded pretty misinformed. The chief information officer's response often was, well, we already have CRM, customer relationship management. What do you bring that's additional? The sales chief would respond by saying, we've just installed CRM. We can buy add-ons and we can achieve whatever you're offering by doing that. The chief financial officer would respond, well, we've just invested in a CRM and we're waiting for that return to roll out to us. Well, Marketo came back understanding that what they were really delivering was sales enablement. And when they started to express their value proposition that way, by the way, there's a link to some of this material that Marketo now uses, and behind that link in their name, you can go to that slide and open it. It's a very good example of the marketing materials that can be used to help equip internal conversations and internal investigations by the stakeholders themselves. So that you'll notice in Marketo's materials, that it's almost like a template for the stakeholders to investigate alternatives to marketing automation. And a lesson we can take away from Marketo's example is as we get to know who the likely stakeholders would be, we know then who to reach out to when we're starting our initiative of sales inside of a company. And we also know what their metrics are likely to be. So we can help facilitate that discussion towards reaching agreement in our favor by both stimulating that discussion and bringing them the metrics that they would all agree to use. An example, which is a client assignment that I was involved with, is that even if when you get the shared value proposition nailed down, it doesn't necessarily mean, and you've got an assignment in hand, it doesn't necessarily mean that the implementation is going to roll out smoothly if you have not touched all of those stakeholders in advance of that purchase decision. So we won this assignment because there was a corporate-wide customer experience improvement project or program underway within this large financial institution. My client's value proposition was an experiential learning platform, and the value proposition, which was successful for us, was don't practice on customers, practice on us. Therefore, our first assignment inside this company was funded by the Learning and Development Group. And the performance metrics for our solution were improved learning. And so the metrics were provided to us by our client, who was the Learning and Development Funding Group. However, as we started rolling out the project, we were working with customer-facing functions in other areas of the business, and there were stakeholders who started to surface as users or as people who were being impacted by our solution. And they came in unexpected ways, but areas that were also being funded out of the customer experience improvement mandate that was company-wide. So for instance, Six Sigma initiatives, mobile platform transactions, which was another touch point for the customer, even branch operations, all had different measures for their initiatives related to customer experience. For instance, the product groups measured their improvement in customer experience relevant to wallet share, to number of products that a client held, or the portfolio size if it was the investment group. The compliance area and information systems had their very different key performance indicators or measures of success for customer experience initiatives that they were involved with. Compliance could have been either accuracy of data that was captured or the time it took to complete a report, or the information systems group was a reduction in the number of reworks of reports. So we got caught in the middle of this, but we learned a lot because as we went out then to other areas of the company, whether it was other operations groups or other business units to win new assignments with them based upon the success of this project, we rolled in this additional knowledge that we had gained. And so from the beginning, as we went out to these other groups to win business with them, all under the same brand, but under different funding areas, we went out and did two things with this knowledge. We immediately, as we were involved in the sales process, we extended our reach to stakeholders outside of learning and development, and we used the key performance indicators or metrics that we knew those groups would use or those functions would use when they were measuring success. So we were able to therefore, with that experience of multiple stakeholders and a variety of different ways of measuring success, and we were able therefore to win a lot of additional assignments inside that company, and therefore we kind of became embedded in their operations, and indeed had several years of almost standing agreement assignments as a result of going and doing the sales process in a way that we had learned the customer was going to buy. So just as a summary then, consensus building among multiple stakeholders is really the sales activity, and we can foster that by both finding out about the other stakeholder groups' points of view and pointing out and sharing among those groups the points of either disconnection or of shared view. And this will help move some or unlock some of the resistance to change, because ultimately if the pain of same, as someone said, is larger than the pain of change, it's up to us to start at pointing out what the risks are if they don't make any changes. Obviously, if we're offering a service or product that can help solve that business issue that we feel they should be addressing and they don't feel it's important enough to address, we've got to shake something loose. And therefore, the role of the salesperson is not just to kind of demonstrate features and benefits and all of that, but really to help them as a group or a variety of different groups who may never have had to talk to each other about this, help them move towards agreement. And what is the outcome for us? Sure, the process takes a bit longer. We have to involve more people. But generally, there are higher priced or higher value types of contracts or agreements that can be won this way. It's often a customer that stays with us because we're the people who've really understood all of the obstacles to the implementation. So that ideal customer with the long tail, they've got a number of different business units we can sell into and can really become embedded in their operations. So why would we bother taking on all the extra effort and time to win a client in this way? Well, we help them work through before we get involved in rolling out or the implementation of our plan, and we help them address in advance the change management obstacles. So it's a cleaner solution that runs better when it's installed generally, and we really become a part of their business because we understand them better than just selling something and handing it off. You can educate yourself about the challenger customer. This is a really good summary of the research that's been published, and I'm always happy to talk with you about what you're facing and try to decode what the customer means when they say that. All the best.